While the wave continues, there's been a constant stream of meditation across the globe, creating a deep sense of peace and personal capacity. We need peace and we need a divine connection now more than ever. It pleases me to introduce our divine sister, Jenna, who's recently released a book titled Meditation, Intimate Experiences with the Divine Through Contemplative Practices, published by Sacred Stories. Sister Jenna is the director of the Brahma Kumaris Meditation Museum in the nation's capital and host of the popular America Meditating radio show. It's no coincidence that the universe has brought together Unify's family to call upon the spiritual resource of the Brahma Kumaris. And on our 24 meditation vigil, we've welcomed yogis from Egypt, Japan, India, Australia, the UK, indeed in all 24 time zones, we've had meditations. Sister Jenna, let me hand over this segment of our synchronized global meditation to you and our distinguished guests. And let's bring our family gathered to the divine, to Baba, Allah, Jehovah, and Source, and raise the vibration of God's love for humanity.
Adele, thank you so much. Om Shanti, everyone. Adele, you're such an example for our future. Do you know that? There's just so much good about you. That's all I can say. And it's been so wonderful working with all of you on this project and this moment in time. I actually don't have words to express my appreciation to you, the team, just everybody. The fact that you've recognized the importance of the purity needed to establish this connection with the divine speaks volumes. Thank you so much. Hello, everyone. So glad that you could join us. Those of you out there in the ethers, wherever you are across the globe, welcome. Welcome on this auspicious day. 2/22/2022 at 2 p.m. PST. We've been traveling on this journey now for almost 24 hours. Have you been feeling the difference inside of you? Are you feeling something shifting for you? Because this is some reason, there's a reason why we're all gathered together. Some of the most beautiful people are about to welcome in 2/22 by bringing in the essence and the vibrations of the divine, of the supreme being. There's no secret. There is an energy in the body that's governing life, that we are souls. And it's definitely a reality that there's something going on in the soul and we're looking for more power and divinity and virtuosity to move forward. Where will we get it? From a deep connection with the source. So it's time for us to go firstly inward and then outwardly, making this connection. Some of our brightest lights are here in our special space here, and they will be definitely joining me as I enter into the space. And I invite you and the world to join me at 2/22 as we bring the energy of the divine within our own beings and allow that to radiate out where it needs to. So let me call in some of my wonderful friends, Sadhvi Ji, always looking forward to being with you. And I'm going to ask each of you just a question, and I just need you to give me two sentences as to how you will respond to my query. So Sadhvi Ji, could you share in just two sentences, how does God feel to you?
Sister Jenna, it's such a beautiful, beautiful opportunity to be with you, Adil, and all of our sisters and brothers. God feels not as two, but as one. And as we are celebrating this day of twos, it feels to me like this exquisite opportunity to realize that we are not two. We are not two separate from God, each other, Mother Nature, ourself, but we are one. So on this day of two, the divine and all feels like one, as it's always been.
Thank you. It was beautiful. I would have never thought of it that way. Gorgeous. Let's move on to Jean Houston. An icon, a legend, a beautiful spirit. She carries such wisdom. She's paved the way on so many levels, everyone. Jean, you are an encyclopedia. I should now call you Google and not encyclopedia. You are a Google of wisdom and source of inspiration. Let's just say, for example, God has descended on earth, what would be the first thing the divine would do based on June Houston's idea of what he should do when he comes here?
I believe that if God arrived, as is happening right now, there would be a kind of musical unfolding which would essentially be saying, the human heart can go to the lengths of God. And as far back as humans can discover, and as far forward as we can imagine, you have the capacity, the spiritual capacity, to understand and to practice the art of union with me, union with reality. And so, in so doing, oh, dear friends, you go into a state of awakening, going off of robot, abandoning lackluster passivity, and engaging co-creation with me with vigor, attention, focus, radiance, what you would also call the mystical experience, the experience of the great one soul. Be not afraid. You were made for these times.
Wow, that is fantastic. I really hope, you know, when the divine does descend, as he descends, I think he is already here, that he taps you on your consciousness so you can tell him what to do. It'll be wonderful. Is Rohan Marley on by chance? Did he come on as yet? Yes? If not, we can kind of move on then, and then I can come back to him.
Jenna, sorry, were you asking for who?
Rohan was on.
One more time?
Rohan.
I think so.
Rohan, are you there?
He's coming. He's just having technical difficulty.
Okay. How about I'll come right back to him. Ricky Cage, how about that? My fellow brother Ricky, all the way staying up so late at night, joining us all the way from India. Your music focuses on the environment, and next month we will also be hosting on 322 a global meditation for water, which I hope you will be able to join us as well. And we often say, you know, that the divine's love is like an endless ocean. How does your environment connect with our relationship with the divine? How do you feel the environment connects with our relationship with the divine?
Thank you so much for having me. And I believe that a connection with, you know, what we call the divine when it comes to the environment can be summed up in one word, that is coexistence. So at the heart of our spirituality, at the heart of our country itself, that is India, there is a Sanskrit phrase called Vasudeva Kutumbakam, which literally means the world is one family. And nowadays, when we think about Vasudeva Kutumbakam, or we think about coexistence, the only thing that comes to our mind is living in peace and harmony between Hindus, Muslims, Christians, Sikhs, Jews, Buddhists, basically different parts of the human race. Because somewhere along a journey of being humans, we've forgotten that we are not the only species on this planet. We are just one among millions and millions of species on this planet. And Vasudeva Kutumbakam actually meant living in absolute peace and absolute harmony, not just with among us humans, but widening the circle, and also among all life on this planet, the forest, the wildlife, and not only that, but also the elements of nature, the water we drink, the air we breathe, the land we walk on. So I believe that this understanding that our survival as a human species completely depends upon our coexistence with every single entity on this planet, whether living or non-living, is key to us becoming a more happier and a more thriving and a more sustainable species.
Awful. Thank you so much. You know, when I hear some of these deep ancient traditions from the East, it brings to light so much power in how much capacity we have here in the soul to really pull wisdom and energy and awareness and consciousness into our lives, so that things can really start to become a little bit more harmonized. I've loved that everyone has been sharing the importance of becoming one, combined. Soul and God together can do wonders. So let's move on. Do we have our brother Prince A.A. in the room? Rohan Marley, are you in the room? No? Has Deepak come on as yet? All right, so let's go to our wonderful brother, Michel Pascal. You have been doing such interesting meditations in Carnegie Hall and in Times Square, and you know, coming on a global meditation like this is no small thing. If you were to meditate anywhere else in the world, apart from where you've meditated already, where would it be and why?
Here, to be with you in the present moment, and also I will say to meditate in the worst place of the world. Peace, it's like oxygen, anywhere, anytime. There is not a place to meditate. My favorite place to meditate, this is Times Square. Because when we calm the mind in the middle of the chaos, if we calm the mind in Times Square, like Frank Sinatra sing, we can do that anytime, anywhere.
Beautiful. I love
it's an honor to be with you, Sister Jenna, and my below Sister Temple's, Reverend Michael, each of you. I feel your soul in my heart, and I really want to say to each of you, Umani Pemeum, all my love to each of you. Thank you, Sister Jenna.
Thank you so much. Beautiful. 2/22/2022. They claim it's a particular period where things are supposed to get completely aligned. Is my soul aligned with the divinity of truth that I put away certain limited beliefs, certain energies, as Adil was saying earlier, algae, anger, lust, greed, attachment, and ego? Can I let these go and actually live from the power of the soul, to bring the power of the soul into my everyday life? I think it's possible, and I think we have that ability to do that. I know that we've got, I think, Joseph I on as well. I don't know if he's available, but also, Adil, you have to help me because I can't see in front of me who might be in our room. But if Rohan is back and Deepak is on, can you give me a signal?
Sure. Yeah, everybody's coming in from different places all over the world. And Richard, you can unmute if you want. This is Prince.
If not, then I can move to maybe Nandiji. Nandiji, you've been on a very unique path as what we would call a guru, but not necessarily a guru. You seem to be somebody who's also seeking the deepest, deepest connection with Source, whether it's through your ancestors and folks that you have learned from, all the rituals and all the prayers that you have done over time. Put aside all of that now. You're the only one left on the planet Earth, and the only source to connect to would be the one above. What do you think the experience of that would be for you?
There is the primordial light within each of us that is so much there in these times, especially for each of us awakening to be. So in this sacred moment is that light lit in each of us as the divine divinity. And this divinity that we have lit for ourselves is that which is in each that is awakening. So in prayers to this light within each of us, this is that which holds all the realities, of experiences and all that which we will unveil and unfold further as our future. So this is, you know, in coming to our oneness, is this light that we shine together with as.
Beautiful, beautiful. Thank you, Nandiji. Always appreciate having our time together and chit-chats, especially because you're so balanced in your approach and many of the things that you do. I do believe Roland is on, and I want to be able to call upon you. I think I saw you moving around. And the reason why I'm kind of calling in this energy before we hold our 22 minutes of sacred remembrance. Richard Dolan has been doing quite some unique stuff out there, and I would love for him to share with us his definition of love and what love really, really means to him.
Well, it's a pleasure to be here with you and each and every one of you. I mean, to be asked such a question is such a profound honor to provide an answer that's true and real for me, but I know in this unique time for us all, you'll find it's also equally unique for us all. For love is to accept is to discover, and to discover is to be open to the invitation, as this is to 2022, to recreate, reclaim, and restore the greatness from within that we were all born with. And yet somehow have lost much of. So I'm delighted to share that insight with you.
Well, and you know, I'm actually appreciating getting to learn more about you too. So I think your answer was beautiful, considering it was so powerful of a question. And love has always been such an interesting word to try to not only answer, but to live it, to live it, to live it. So I hear our brother Rohan has gotten his tech thing together. So Rohan, from one Jamaican to another Jamaican man, I'm sure how many people have you heard was raised by your dad's music, Bob Marley? And you know, my mother, who is a real good Jamaican and makes the best Jamaican jerk tofu, right? I used to love to hear, if your dad were to compose a song on God, what do you think the title of that song would be?
Unity is love, you know? Together as the human race, you know, we need to find that we're all one kind, and, you know, we have the same father as the humanity, and that, you know, I myself, when I listen to my father's music, and being that, you know, he left us at such a young age when we were only 9 years old, we always try to find that within the realms of the universe and know that in the higher consciousness is where that one lives. And when I seek my father in this present time and place, I seek him in a higher self and a higher presence. And I know that within that higher consciousness that we all exist. And that's when we can elevate our mind to a greater love, because in that place, it's a unity and it's a strength for oneness. And you know, as we look into the universe and the stars, what I see for sure is that each of us, we're connected to each star, and we're all a beam of light. So we just have to exist as light as we are. And my father's music would be about that.
You know, many times when I would listen to your father's music, it was like he was just connected to, you know, I call God Baba.
Yes.
He was just connected to Baba, Rohan. It was in him.
It's true, you know, because the truth is the passion and the love that's within us as beings of light. And when you tap into that source, you become selfless and you just want to be love. And love is for, like you say, is an action. But in the action, you get the reaction. It's a feeling that you get within ourselves, and we feel overwhelmed with this joy and love. So, you know, it's like being tapped in. And when you're tapped in, being able to deliver that passion that's from within your soul is the most magnificent feeling. And like you said, on this day, which is all the days of, you know, happen so often, you know, we feel really, really wonderful today that this is happening. And, you know, I can be here as well with each and every one, the great, great minds, great leaders here, and to just share this truth that we're trying to express, which is love. And that, you know, in the time where there's war here and war there and weapons of destruction and this, all these different things that's bringing us, creating separation, it's wonderful that our minds can come together and still drive that force, which is love, that we need amongst each other. Rastafari is that.
Rastafari, Haile Selassie, Wapen.
That is so true.
Rohan, thank you. Thank you so much.
Blessed love.
So, blessings to you, my brother. Blessings to you. So let's take this moment now as we really get to enter now into our 222 moment. Everyone, please, I ask you, make sure your camera's on, you're sitting up straight. Get ready now to actually invite the energy of the divine, of the supreme through you. We want to end poverty. We want to end suffering. We want to end fear. We want to end it in ourselves first, and we want to be able to allow the vibration of the clarity in our system to spread far and wide. So now, as we welcome in the 222 moment of the hour, I invite you to sit for the next 22 minutes with us through sound, through silence, through visuals. Let's take this moment. We'll emerge this video that has the introduction of the supreme energy in a language that we call Man Manabhav. Just imagine yourself sitting somewhere on the earth, in whatever country, city, space. And you're aware that your body is simply your vehicle to get you around here and there. But you really are the driver of the body, the soul. And it is the soul that is making this connection to the divine. In contemplation, the divine light, and the divine being. So just gently rest your eyes on the visuals of the three levels of consciousness, the world of light, seeing the earth. Bridge the divide and become one between you, the soul, and the supreme. Thank you. imagine yourself detached. Imagine letting go of the role that you play and the titles that you hold. They're not important right now. Let go of your attachment to religion, language, nationality. Familiarity of being in your body, just let it go. And if you have no attachment to anyone or anything, who would you think of and who would think of you? It would be the divine. Soul that sits gently behind your eyes would feel unlimited and free. And it would naturally experience claiming an inheritance in the divine light, supreme being. Let us keep holding the silence for a little longer. Allowing the intimacy of Baba's light, God's light, Jehovah, Allah, to just flow through you. Imagine walking around the planet as a clear channel of love. Just pure, unadulterated love. All four corners of the earth will become pure. Imagine if every day we chose to hold the sacredness as an intimate connection and intimate commitment to our soul's truth, our collective truth, collective humanity. Can unify their hearts. And create a golden age of love. Inside, you know who you are. On the sacred day, let's commit to being connected to the divine. The divinity in each one. We slowly and gradually bring the energy back into the space, sort of bringing the energy of the divine now back on ground level. Whatever we were experiencing up above, we bring it down below. The power of the intimacy between the soul and God, and walking through our lives, relationships, places, and things, How beautiful would it be? Our 22 minutes being held has been moving, solid, pure, sweet divinity. Take a deep breath in. Breathe out. Breathe in again. Breathe out. Beautiful. Thank you, everyone. We might not be able to see it with our physical eyes exactly, but I think with the soul, we know that the world has become a better place as our collective resonance between the soul and the divine just took place. I'd like to invite my dear sister, Kristen Hoffman, who just recently launched a beautiful track that you can get on Bandcamp or on Spotify. The title of the song is called Sweet Divine, and I'd like to invite her up to just share briefly the introduction of the video of the album, of the song, but just the inspiration of the song and what it means. Hi, Kristen.
Sister Jenna, it's such an honor to be with you and everyone today on this day of 222222. And I'm so excited to be introducing this brand new song called Sweet Divine. And Sister Jenna, you always have this way of inspiring me and lighting my divine creative spark. And this song wouldn't have come into being without you. We were on the phone this past year, and I was getting ready to go on the America Meditating radio show the following day. And Sister Jenna and I were saying, oh, wouldn't it be beautiful to bring through a brand new energy, a brand new piece? And author Caroline Mace was going to be on the following day. And her new book title inspired this song. And I came on the next morning, I wrote the song at night, and I shared this song live. And now the beauty is that this brand new book has come into being by Sister Jenna, with so many beautiful co-authors. And now this song gets to also support this incredible book as it flows into the lives of so many around the world. So it's an honor to introduce Sweet Divine. In a nutshell, this song just talks of that simple connection that we experience when we get quiet within ourselves. We can be anywhere. We can be in nature. We can be in the loudest place on earth. But if we just get quiet, we tune in, and we listen, we are immediately, we have that instantaneous connection to divine at all times. And hopefully this song will help to spark that remembrance within you. And I think we're going to have a chance to watch a brand new music video, which Sister Jenna put together in honor of the song release.
Thank you, Kristen.
Guide me with a map of signs. Let me know that it's all right. It's all right. Sweet divine, when we speak in deepest prayer, in the silence feel you there, like you're always so aware of me. Oh, sweet divine. back to heart and home. Help me hear the truest tone of who I am. Sweet divine, even when I'm living asleep, forgotten how to listen deep, you find a way to sing to me through the night.
Intimate relationship with the divine, I still get teary-eyed whenever Kristen Hoffman sings. Wasn't that beautiful, everyone? Did you feel that energy? Did you feel that? That divinity coming through you and taking you to a whole nother dimension within yourself. Well, as we're moving into another part of the program, I have to bring on a young man who's been a very big inspiration for millions around the globe, Prince EA. Prince EA, you have been a remarkable example. The way that you showed up, just being you, and because of your curiosity about life and your ability to catch mystical things about life, we love that in you. Prince EA, if you were to somehow look at technology and figure out a way and how it can deepen our link to source, what would you say or what would you do in order to do that? And thank you so much for joining us. I'm sure this has been a very meaningful moment for you as well.
It has, Sister Jenna. Wow, what a question. This is a question that I have been contemplating for a long time, because technology is so pervasive, right? Specifically digital. I mean, it's in every avenue of our lives. So how do we shift that into a place that can bring us closer to ourselves, to love, to God, whatever name we want to use? This is the question. This is the the million-dollar question, the big domino that I think will knock all the other little dominoes down. So my answer would be, we would have to use this technology to allow us to pause, stop, keep quiet. It wouldn't be anything that would make us think, that would make us concentrate, but it would be a technology that would simply move us or guide us into this present moment fully. Because I was gonna say believe, but I know that only in this present moment is life discovered. So that would be my answer, is to use technology in a way that could allow the mind to stop. As Papaji would say, keep quiet. And only in that quietude will we be able to recognize first the illusions of what we think we are, and we will be able to surrender and fall into who we truly are as one.
Beautiful. You know, this need for inner silence is the call of our time. You know, you had thought that a smartphone was the greatest invention to mankind, but Prince Aya, it's really the power of our inner silence should be the greatest invention right now, isn't it? Mm. Your whole world can be revealed in the power of your silence. Yeah. Well, I wanted to let everyone know, this is it. I wanted everyone to know that as I sign off from my segment with all of you, it's my pure wish that it's been a life-raising experience, a soul-raising experience in this hour that we've spent together. This is only the beginning. This is only the beginning of us raising the vibration. This is a pebble in the lake, and it's rippling out the call of our time, love for the one above, to be love down below. It gives me great pleasure to welcome the great, amazing, the Reverend Dr. Michael Beckwith on. And Michael Beckwith is the spiritual founder of the Agape Spiritual Center, an author, a person who has helped the lives of millions of people. I'm sure you might have seen him just recently on Ellen DeGeneres, and he almost blew up her comments field just because everything that Brother Michael says, it's true. It hits you at a deep level. He's somebody that I've turned to when I've had some rough times, and he's never failed to always say the right thing at the right moment. I'm handing over the rest of the half hour to our brother, Michael Beckwith, and I believe maybe Chief Phil Lane wants to come up before I go to say hello, I was told. So maybe if I just hold off just for 20 seconds, Michael, before I put you on. Of course, I have to give reverence to our beautiful Chief Phil Lane as he moves on to his program that's going to start in about 30 minutes. Chief Phil Lane, welcome. Thank you so much for joining. Is he on? He was asking to be on.
Yes.
Are you there?
To get me off mute. There we go.
There you go. Hello, my divine brother. There we go.
And so I just extend my heartfelt, profound love and compassion for your beautiful meditation. And of course, for Toja, her beautiful singing. It always transports me beyond the murmur of syllables and sounds of that world beyond time. And of course, the beautiful comments on technology. I know Reverend Michael Beckwith is coming on. We've been at this since really early this morning. I just want to add, so I understand the sequence here. So I'll come back in 30 minutes because I need to go from one place to the other with my wife. And so I didn't want to interrupt. And so I didn't want to interrupt Michael. So I'll see you in about 30.
Beautiful. Thank you, Philane. Okay. Many blessings.
Big hugs. And again, thank you so, so much. And I want to remark about when it comes to my time about the soul, the soul that you so beautifully distinguished out of all, the sovereignty, ancient and perishable, everlasting. So I thank you so much.
Thank you, Chief Elaine. Thank you. Oho. Thank you. Dr. Michael Beckwith, thank you so much. And I would love if you could take us into some beautiful sharing for the first 10 minutes and just deepen what we've been doing for the last hour. And then feel free to invite the rest of our luminaries to share the next half hour with you. Everyone, I sign out. Take care. Lots of blessing. Unlimited love to each and every one of you. And may you really always carry a little space in your heart for Baba. Just keep Baba with you in your heart. Magical things will happen for you. Thanks so much. Adil, see you soon. Michael, I hand it over to you.
Thank you very much, Sister Jenna, and all of us obviously appreciate the moment of sacred silence, the moment of quietude, solitude, the sense of breaking free from any pathological perceptivity that would have us see other than the one power, the one presence, the one love, the one life that is everywhere in its fullness, and that by means of us is seeking to come into its own as each and every one of us. Obviously, in moments of meditation, we move into a mystic perceptivity where we come to an understanding that the suffering of humanity comes from humanity's inability to see reality, capital R, reality, that the presence is everywhere. The presence is everywhere in its fullness. It cannot parcel itself out. It cannot break itself into parts. It is not anywhere more than it is in anywhere else. So we would not say that God is in all creation. We would say all creation is in God. For the presence of God is infinite, everywhere, not absorbed by its creation. But all creation is in the presence. And so our moments of meditation allow us to break free from the pathology of separation, the pathology of distance, the pathology of lost in time and space, and come to a greater awareness of our timeless, infinite nature, and to know the difference between our consciousness, our pure awareness, and the content that's passing through. Through moments of meditation that we have just shared, we come to an understanding that just as the ocean, whether we call it the Indian Ocean or the Atlantic Ocean or the Pacific Ocean, is water, and then there is content in that water. There's seaweed, there's human pollution, there's boats, there's fish. But we never mistake the ocean for the content. As we grow and unfold and expand our awareness, we never mistake our consciousness for the content that's passing through. The content is opinions, points of view, perceptions, positionality, interpretation of past experiences. That's all content. And as we wake up, we begin to see that we're not the content that's passing through. We're the awareness that the content is passing through. And so that sense of pathological perceptivity dissolves. And we see, as Nandaji reminded us, that light, that tremendous luminosity, that we are indeed the light. The light that lights up every man and every woman that comes into the world, the same light that's found in every avatar that's walked the planet, that luminosity takes us over. And so for such a time in human history where the old, that which is not in cadence with the fundamental harmony of the universe, that which is decadent, is dying, and that which is in cadence with the next great leap of humanity into the next great vision and version of who we are, as we're in this condensed state, as we're in this period where two things are occupying the same space and the same time, but in different vibratory frequencies, we need more and more of us to be able to see, not with eyes, to hear, not with ears, but with pure consciousness, that which is real, that which is eternal, that which is forever, that which is timeless, and allow it to be so active within us, to be so activated through our inner work that we glow with it and are able to anchor, as Sister Jenna was reminding us, to anchor the ever expanding good, heaven, anger, God on earth. So during this time of human history, we're not seeking to be ascended masters in any way, shape, or form. We're seeking through integration to be descended masters, to actually bring our expanded awareness and use time and space as a canvas by which we paint with the colors of our soul, the beauty, the love, the richness, the generosity, the compassion, the kindness, the givingness, the forgivingness. All of that gets to flow through us when we're able to see, not with eyes, to hear, not with ears. For in those moments of meditation that we've just had with each other, we begin to be reminded that we do not see because we have eyes. We have eyes because we see. We do not hear because we have ears. We have ears because we hear. That form always follows consciousness. So the spiritual inner technology of sight, to see the invisible, we had that as consciousness. The spiritual technology to hear the inaudible, we had that as consciousness. And then we produced eyes and ears to operate in this particular dimension of time and space. So in meditation, we're activating our spiritual faculties and not totally relying upon the prosthetics of those spiritual faculties called our eyes and ears, of which millions of people are lost in time and space because all they have to navigate with is their five senses, but not us. Through the power of meditation and intentionality, that inner fervor to wake up, we begin to see differently. We begin to see possibility, begin to see opportunity. We begin to see that this presence, by whatever name we choose to call the presence, is everywhere, smiling at us through the flowers, bending to our divinity from the trees, reeking with its holiness the ground upon which we are standing. And as Michelle mentioned, we embrace our, someone mentioned, we embrace, maybe it was Richard, all sentient beings and all species, Mother Earth, rainforest, the sense of separation breaks down and we see the presence of God's life shining through all of its creation, while the presence of creation, while that creation is in God, separation dissolved, disintegrated. Now, inspired wisdom, transformational knowledge, creative intelligence, spontaneous goodness, unconditional love, the dynamic of peace, which is the dynamic of harmonizing good flowing through us, is activated. And we choose, our ability to choose is increased. We are less reactionary, we're more choiceability. The choiceability is enhanced. And we find our particular dharma as to how we are going to leave a dynamic, beautiful, blissful vibrational footprint on the planet. So we don't walk on the planet saying we don't want to leave a footprint. We say we want to leave a footprint of bliss and ecstasy beyond sustainability, a footprint of bliss and ecstasy and generosity and love and beauty. This is what we're called to live, you see, this time in human history. And to be reminded that the biggest virus on the planet is the virus of the mind called fear. We hear the teachings of Yeshua ben Joseph, otherwise known as Jesus the Christ. It said, fear not, little flock, fear not. It is God's good pleasure to give us the kingdom. And so with right seeing, fear is transmuted into excitement. Excitement is transmuted into enthusiasm, in theos, in God. And we get a direct wisdom and guidance as to what is our calling on the planet at this time in human history to help us move to the next level. next stage of our unfolding. One last word. We have to be able to stay in a state before the next stage emerges. State precedes stage. We're in a state of peace, state of harmony, state of love, vibrating at a state of unity. Then that which is within us, our destiny, the next stage can unfold. We have to integrate and stabilize a state, which is why we meditate. And then the stage unfolds. We can't have the next stage without a state. It's not going to just happen. It happens just by law. And so our time together today, all of us holding that space, and all of the countless people around the world tuning in, to be turned on to the ineffable, we have a global state of consciousness, of unity, and of oneness that now can give birth to a next stage of unfolding. So it's been my joy to receive the handoff from my sister Jenna, and to hear all of the wonderful beings that have spoken. And I'll call forth at this moment, Drumbolo to speak into this moment, this time in human history. What is this time calling us for? Calling forth from us.
I think I have a voice.
I hear you and I see you.
Okay. Hi, everyone. I'm Drumbolo Melchizedek, and I've.
Big screen, please.
How do I do that? I don't know.
I can see and hear you.
Yeah, I can see and hear you too, but I can't get the screen big if that's what. View, maybe that's it.
Drumbolo, oh,
full screen. There we go.
Yeah.
I think I. Well, that didn't do much. Well, okay. I don't care if I'm little. But I think.
There you go.
Oh, there we go. Okay, life is good. We're back to little one again.
But we can hear you fine.
Okay, I'll just go. You guys ready? This was a very good meditation. That's all I do my whole life is sit and meditate. The last 5 years, I've been doing nothing but that, just about. And I've come to a place where what you're talking about, it's now totally possible now, right now, today, that we can become one with all life everywhere on every single level of existence. We didn't know this was possible for a long time because we believed that the speed of light was the limiting factor in the universe. It's not. The United States discovered in 1969 that there's something a little faster than light. Light is 186,200 miles a second. And at that rate, it would just to go across the known universe, we couldn't talk to anyone. It would never even reach anywhere before it would not be possible. So in 1969, they discovered a new kind of light, a brand new light, and it will change every single thing on Earth completely. This is one thing I can actually promise. So it's called the Birkeland currents. And they kept it secret from 1969 until 2010, I believe. It might have been 2011. They would not even let you talk about it. They would arrest you if you talked about it. And because they knew that when this was understood, the Earth would change very fast all human beings and our relationships to all life on the planet and everywhere, not just here, everywhere, because we would be able to communicate with every single living thing in existence, no matter where it is. Because this light, this new light that we have just discovered, is able to move. Well, the original mathematics, when they started to do it, said it was 20 billion times faster than the speed of light. And that almost gives communication throughout the universe. But actually, they found that it is, they went through stages trying to figure out what it was until they got to the place where they just kept increasing it to 900 billion times faster than the speed of light, which would make it instantaneous everywhere. But they finally realized that what the speed of what it Birkeland currents move at is they don't move, they just simply become everywhere in zero time, no time at all. And so this is huge for spirituality and for everything else that we're involved in, because right now it's possible to take all the information in the universe. It says the host muted me, so I guess I'm not talking anymore. Is that true?
Nope, you're good. You're good.
I can hear you.
Okay, I'll keep going. What they now know, what science now knows and has proven, that you can send everything, all knowledge, every single bit of data in the entire universe, and send it not just from point A to point B, but to every single place, every single point in existence, and all in zero time. Which means that the universe is communicating with itself just like our body is. It's communicating with every single life form in existence. And every single life form has the ability or the possibility of communicating back. And in my meditation with the Birkeland currents, I've learned to do this. I can talk to the entire universe and they can speak back with me. And I can prove it. I can do things that will demonstrate. But I don't think I want to do that anymore. At any rate, what has just happened has opened up a possibility here on Earth that the ascended masters that someone was talking about, they can't do this. They don't even know how to do this, because I'm in communication with them all the time. They don't know how to do this. And it's going to emerge on the Earth in the next year or so. And what will then happen is somebody also talked about technology and how would we use technology? Well, the thing is, and what I know to be fact, is that technology is a stage of consciousness. You get to this point where you understand this technology and you can create it to do anything you want. But eventually what happens as consciousness evolves through the Birkeland currents, we learn that, and this happens in a single day, and we're going to experience this on a single day, all of our technology is going to be turned off. We're not going to need it anymore, because everybody here will have discovered that we can do anything that technology does and way more than it's capable of. We can actually do anything that you can imagine. And so if you can't imagine it, you can't create it. And there's another huge thing that is important for people in where you're at right now. And that is to understand, I want to think about this just for a moment. Well, okay. I'm not sure that I should bring this up at this time, so I'm going to wait on something else. But we have created a possibility right now. And that possibility will be available to us. It's available right now to anyone that can do it, but it's going to be a possibility that is absolutely amazing, where every single person on earth that has a heart, because it's done from the heart and not from the brain. The brain is not what we think it is. If you look back into ancient times, like ancient Egypt, they considered the brain a piece of junk. They took all the sacred things out of the body, the heart, the genitals, and a lot of other things, and they put them in very special places, in clay pots, four clay pots. And then when it came to the brain, they took it out and threw it in a garbage can. That's how much that we considered the brain to be important. It is really not important. It only becomes important when it's connected to the heart, and the heart has control of the brain. And when it has control of the brain, everything that the brain creates is no longer polarized. The brain is polarized. We got a left brain that is left brain that is male, that is and there's the right brain, which is female, and it's polarized. The brain is actually made into two pieces, but the heart is not polarized. It has no polarization. And what science calls singularity, which is unity or oneness, the heart has that. It is the only place in the human body and around the body, out farther to the Merkaba and the light body that goes out. There is no limitation on this at all. And when we begin to remember and begin to function from our heart, and not just love, but the heart has its own array of emotions that are the same ones that are in the brain, but the brain has polarized. In other words, you have heart, you have love, and you have hate. And every single thing that comes from the brain has an opposite part. But that's not true with the heart. The heart has love, and there is no other aspect other than that. And so all the feelings that we have would only come from a sense of oneness and caring for every single thing. We will know. We're coming to this place. We're going to know that we, as an individual, are just one little component in everything that has been created from the source of life. And that source of life lives, yes, it is everywhere, but it is also in the heart of every single thing that breathes.
Yeah.
And so we're sitting right on the edge of this. It's all tied to the progression of the equinoxes and to this thing that was 12 that was an opening that has not completely opened yet, and so we think that it's over with and done, but it isn't, and we have a little bit more time. I don't know how much that is. Only Mother Earth and Father Sun know that. But we have a little, we have.
thank you.
And it's coming that is just extraordinary. And we all have this opportunity to become one with all life everywhere. Mm. And so I'm excited. I am excited because I don't know why they let me, but they let me go ahead and to test it. And it is extraordinary. And it's because we didn't know about Birkeland currents. Tesla was almost there. He was working with electricity that didn't go through wires that J.P. Morgan had us doing, and we're still doing that. But he was trying to see how it would go in a vacuum. And he didn't realize that it was in nature, in outer space, that is the only place that a Birkeland current can actually create plasma and all these beautiful things you see all throughout the whole universe. We have been blessed. We have been really blessed. And poor Tesla, if he would have just, he was murdered, and it was a sad thing that this happened, but he was very close to understanding, and we could have had this back in 1943 instead of now.
Thank you.
It's here. Okay.
Thank you so much. Appreciate that magnificent lesson of teaching what the mystics have been talking about, that we can transcend time and space, and anything that's known in one place in divine mind is known instantly everywhere. And so now we're moving into that state of consciousness where that will prevail. We have a couple of moments left. Is Mama Makita.
Oh, sorry, Michael, my apologies. We did that wrong. Is it okay to queue up Chief Villain and then Mama Makita?
Oh, okay. Sorry. I thought he was coming on at 3:30. Okay, I'm just reading what Sister Jenna gave me.
Okay, no worries. Chief Villain's the timing. Thank you so much.
Let's have her first. Let's have her first. And then at 3:30, because Michael has us just exactly spiritually in grace the way it should be. Let's do that.
Is Mama Makita available to speak into this space?
She popped off. I think technically popped off here. She had an unstable connection.
Hey, what about Yaki Awakened?
Popped off as well. Ariki Nui Kawanata?
Yes. Yeah, sorry. I didn't expect anybody to call me through.
This is your moment. Take a moment and just speak into this space of what's happening and what we're bringing to history at this moment.
Thank you. I'll just bring myself online. I'm just walking around the home listening. I'm on my mobile, so I do appreciate you giving me the opportunity. You know, there's a lot that's been covered this morning, and knowing about the oneness of the spirit that I understand is for every one of you a part of me, and I'm part of you. So that's the oneness, and we're all separated and divided, you know, to experience as a multiple of one. And we've all come back together. And we are now merging into a new shift of spirit. And there's different things that are opening up now that are allowing us all to come together. Yesterday, when I was connected and contacted by Adil and Mark, it was sort of caught me off guard, because I've been down here in New Zealand doing my own little thing, and I've always wondered where all the different parts of the puzzle were. And it's great to know that many of you are out there and you exist, and you know, we all have that one consciousness, so we're pretty aligned on the way we think. And so I do appreciate that. I came on initially. I wore my cultural feathers in that. I turned myself off and got undressed and basically just listened in. I appreciate. It's an honor for me to be here to represent New Zealand. It's also known as Aotearoa, the land of the long white cloud, with the land that is the first to see the sun. So I always make a joke about I'm in your future, because we are ahead of everybody else in time. So I appreciate that I can come together in one place, in that now time, now space. And these smartphone devices and technology today helps us do that, doesn't it? So, you know, it's great to actually come together with all of you. I really do appreciate the feedback and the, I suppose, the storylines and understanding from different parts of the world. It's great to see that, you know, what I know of this realm that we're in, around the Great Wall of Ice, that we are the outer, what we call the heavenly realm. People don't realize that we're all already here. And everything below us is basically, you know, the past existences of the past floods and everything like that, mud floods, you know, just wiping out certain worlds. And so we've just developed from there. So it's good to be here today. Thank you very much. I did not expect myself to be called through, and I apologize. I was sort of sitting down listening and just having a little bite to eat. We're actually in the sort of early afternoon here, and I do appreciate you all just to share that love with you and to honor everybody that's here. So thank you very much for the time to give me that time to have a bit of a word. I'll leave it there at this stage. Thank you.
And thank you. Thank you for your participation and your radiance and what you have thank brought. So now we turn it over to Chief Lane.
Yes. And thank you. Thank you so much. So much. I want to extend a very, very warm greeting to my dear Maori brother, as we know that through the Kon-Tiki expedition and our histories, that our relationship across the Pacific to Aotearoa is one. So we're all part of the same prophecy of the reunion of the condor, the quetzal, and the eagle that's being fulfilled at this time. So I want to just reach out and say that and thank everybody, and especially for the timing on this, as I have an elder that I need to attend to that's kind of come up with my attention. But I want also to be here at this very, very key historic time when we are changing the whole movement forward to an upward movement. It's been hidden underneath, but now it's happening. And so with that in mind, I want to use this eagle bone whistle four times to remember that as in a practical sense, as Einstein and Tesla said, the future of medicine is frequency. It's the frequency of these spiritual teachings that resonate, for instance, in the sacred songs of the white buffalo calf woman, who still sustains through her holy words, the Ocheti Shekoan, or the sacred words that sustain the people of the longhouse to the peacemaker, or those through the teaching of Lord Jesus Christ, or whatever sacred teachings there are. It's through that sacred vibration, that sacred frequency, that we tune in, as we're doing here in this beautiful meditation we've had. Now I'd like to pray to our most highest. Ojin Kashla Wakantaga, creator of the universe, most beloved one, all powerful one, most kind one, most compassionate one, ever forgiving one, omniscient one, magnificent one, ever abiding one, O ancient of days, O blessed beauty, we call upon your holy power at this time. And all your holy messengers, all your holy teachers, each and every one of them, we call upon them at this time to come here in unity and harmony, one heart and one mind in many bodies, as we ascend to this promised time in our destiny as prophesied by our sacred prophecies everywhere on our beloved Mother Earth. We give thanksgiving at this time for all our ancestors who have gone before us, who are closer than our closest vein, who are walking before us, making the path clear and visible for us as we move forward. We give thanksgiving in that manner, with great thanksgiving. And at the same time, we look forward with great happiness and joy to the coming years as we move forward with the undoubtable vision to end war and begin peace on earth by 2030. And we know, for whatever reason yet to be understood, that nation states of Mother Earth will be compelled to come together and sign a binding treaty to end war. And that will begin the flowering of what we have, the seven sacred fires that will lead to the most great peace. A time foretold in all the sacred prophecies. We give thanksgiving, Creator, for that understanding. The Kashal Wakanta, we call upon all the tribes and nations of the east, from where comes the red sunrise, to come together in unity and harmony, as we've been crying upon them for all these years, for more than 500 years since the union of the condor, the quetzal, and the eagle was broken. We've been calling upon this prayer. Black Elk, you said it so beautifully. We call upon that holy power at this time. The east, from where comes the red sunrise, the south, from where comes new life. That new life, we call upon all those tribes and nations that have come together in unity and harmony, as we've been echoing this through our covenant with the Creator from the beginning of time that has no beginning. In the Kashala Wakandaka, Creator of the universe, most beloved one, all powerful one, we call upon all the tribes and nations of the west, from where comes thunder, lightning, and rain. We call upon that spiritual power of thunder, lightning, and rain to awaken our hearts and minds. The spiritual reality that each of us is a sovereignty, ancient, imperishable, and everlasting. Nikash the Wakantaka, Creator of the universe, most beloved one, most magnificent one. We call upon all the tribes, nations of the north, from where comes the white snow. There's purifying north winds to purify our hearts and minds so that it leaves no attachment to anything of this material world. Instead, we'll walk in the world of light. Time when it's been foretold that those in the spiritual world and those in this world will become one. The veils will be removed in the world of light. We give thanksgiving that manner. We give thanksgiving to Father Sky at this time. We ask that the masculine dimension of life might humble themselves before womankind and learn. We've brought this as far as we can take it, and we can see the more these masculine elements go forward in the way we're going forward, the worse the conditions get of Mother Earth. And we ourselves are fully responsible as men for what we find ourselves here. It's time to understand it's womankind who will form the hoop of many hoops. They're the ones that will teach us and lead us. So I ask my brothers, my uncles, my grandfathers, my grandsons, my nephews, my relations, and let's listen. We've taken it as far as we can do it, and we've destroyed almost our Mother Earth in doing so. And I say that as collective men upon this earth in that way. But we also know and give thanksgiving to those grandfathers, fathers, all our ancestors who also stood up as spiritual warriors who never surrendered their covenant with the Creator, who never gave up. For we're born wild and we're going to die wild. Because we know each of us has created a sovereignty, unique. And then we humble ourselves before our beloved mother and our mothers who brought us forth from the wombs of this world and gave us life. And for only that, and for only that to our fathers, we give thanksgiving at this time. I want to conclude this sharing comments on the soul. I think it's very important. Sister Jenna brought this up. Our soul is independent of and the very source of our body's existence. If our body is destroyed, our soul and spirit remain unharmed. Our soul, our human spirit, is independent of our physical body. Our soul is free and sanctified beyond this physical place of time and space. All the powers that distinguish us human beings, reason, memory, abstract thought, creativeness, inventiveness, willpower, are all properties of our soul, not our body. A love that anyone may have had for anyone, will not be forgotten in the spiritual worlds, nor will we forget the life we had in this physical world, in those worlds yet to come. In the spiritual world, we will recognize one another We will seek union, a spiritual union. And right here, we're seeking that. We are living in the spiritual world now. What do we see when I see my beautiful Toja? I see her because I see her spirit. That is what counts, is a spirit. The relationship of our soul with our body is like the connection between a lamp and a mirror. If the mirror is polished and perfected, the light of the lamp appears, but the mirror is broken or covered with dust, the light remains concealed. Last three. Our rational soul, the human spirit, does not descend into our bodies or exist through our physical bodies. It's just the opposite. Our soul is the very substance and foundation upon which our body depends upon for existence itself. So soul has no gender, race, ethnicity, or class. This reality makes all forms of prejudice, whatever they may be, intolerable and unacceptable completely. The soul is not divided. It is a reflection of the oneness of our beloved, magnificent, majestic creator. Our soul is endowed from our beginning in this physical world of time and space with its own individuality. Our soul does not acquire it because of our body. The individuality and of our soul are strengthened in this physical world through our spiritual tests and difficulties, which we know very, very well, each and every one of us. Or as they say, you think you say you believe and will not be tested? You think you say you'll believe and will not be tested? Of course, we'll be tested. But this is our day. This is our day. And the foundation of this whole thing is the understanding, the prior unity and oneness of the human family. Because once that unity is there, once we see each and every one of ourselves as a true relative, and the herd of one is the herd of all the rest will be resolved. That's the core, is the unity. So I'm going to close this prayer for unity and give thanksgiving for this beautiful, beloved day we have here on the 22nd, the turning point. This is the turning point. From here, we go forward with one heart and one mind and many bodies. Knowing that every step forward, yes, there will be challenges, but the unseeable, vast, unlimited resources and spiritual relatives who are there, spiritual warriors behind us, will vanquish any hopes of our destruction, and all the forces of disunity shall be transformed into unity. Oh my God, unite the hearts of thy servants, and reveal unto them thy great purpose. May they follow thy commandments and abide in thy law. Help them, O God, in their endeavor, and grant them strength to serve thee. O God, lead them not to themselves, but guide their steps by the light of knowledge, and cheer their hearts by thy love. Verily, thou art the help of the Lord. Aid me, O my Lord, to surrender myself wholly thy will, and to arise and serve thee. For I cherish this earthly life for no other purpose than to encompass the tabernacle by revelation and the seat of thy glory. Halami chante washtelo, shunk mano he meado, chidupasapa he meado, halami chante washtelo. My names are shunk mano, a leader of warriors who takes the enemy's best horses. My name is chidupasapa, a sacred black pipe born of thunder, lightning, and rain, and I stand responsible before the creator for my words and my actions. Halami chante washte. Thank you. Oh. And really, I'm just intense, not angry.
Chief Lane, thank you so much for bringing that dynamic. And we have a special being that we want to call forth right now. And I know she's going to be ready. Hold on 1 second. Here you go. Mama Makeba, are you ready to come on and share a couple of minutes with us?
I'm trying. Can you hear me? Okay.
Yeah, I can hear you.
Great. I'm just going to take a few minutes just to say Ubuntu. It means we all exist because of each other. And I exist because of you. So everything in this universe is interconnected. And we just stay in the present moment, not the past, not the future, but the present moment is a gift. And to know that we work for everyone, this whole universe is about all of us, all of we. And we have to really work for our children and our children's children's children. Native Americans say that we're responsible for 5 generations before us and after us. So the children are very important right now, and that's what we're working with at the Wolby Cultural Center here in Balboa Park. A plant-based diet is a must for what's going on with climate change and all the things that are happening now with their food. It's soil, not oil. And like Dr. Vedana Shiva says, that we have to get to the core of GM foods, Franken foods. You are what you eat and you become what you think. So we have to really save our food, our soil, our bodies, because we don't have health, we cannot have wealth. We cannot have the meditations and the life that we want to give, leave on this planet. So it's important that we take care of our body temple, our minds. So I just have to say, stay in the present moment. Have an Ubuntu philosophy, because we can't exist without each other. Everything in this universe is interconnected. So thank you very much. I loved all of you. And one day, I hope we will all emerge together on this beautiful platform. Thanks, everyone. And I admire all of you. I've been, most of you, I've always followed. Again, Ubuntu, all power to the people.
Outstanding, thank you. And all of us love you as well. Brother Jonathan Granoff is gonna come forward and share a final moment with us. Brother Jonathan. Is Jonathan with us?
Yes.
See you again, brother.
Oh, there we go. Thank you. Michael, what would you have me talk about? And for how long? I've been here since the beginning. I had to go up a brother, an innocent brother in a prison in Pennsylvania. I did a prison project for 12 years, and a lot of these guys are innocent. He's in for 65 to 120 for a crime he didn't commit, but he lives in a cell, and he turned it into a monastic process, affirming all the things we're talking about. So I had to leave for a little bit, and I didn't get a... What is the stream? Where are we?
The stream is we're at a particular time in human history. What are we bringing to this particular moment on 2-2-2-2-2-2? You have the final moment. It's just a moment. Maximum 2 moments. Just bring your heart to this moment, Jonathan.
Always bring my heart, brother. Can't leave the heart. We're in a unique moment in human history in which the ancient admonition of the Upanishads, the world is one family, always the doorway to the realization of the unity of the self with the unity of the soul and the unity of all being. That spiritual admonition, the doorway to the path itself, not the path, but the doorway to the path, because it exists in the realm of multiplicity, duality, change. But that insight has now become, for the first time in human history, a practical necessity. Because the technologies that we've developed to melt the polarized cap, technologies we've developed to be able to vaporize billions of people in an afternoon with nuclear weapons, the technologies that we've developed to actually destroy the third lung, the phytoplankton that breathes us all, have not been matched by the technology to melt the heart. And that's our job. The doorway to the luminosity of the soul is on the other side of the movement from love of self to selfless love. The distance between the human being and God doesn't exist. The illusion of separation and the attachment to what arises from the illusion is the cause of suffering. The doorway is not by pursuing happiness for oneself. How paradoxical is the actual doorway? The doorway is compassion, to feel the suffering of others as one's own, and then to act on that. And the gift of that is the compassion of the great power that sources us. To love others allows us to be loved by the beloved. To serve others allows us to be served by the one who served us life. So by giving up the illusion of separation, which is reinforced by the ignorance of anger, falsehood, jealousy, race, nationalism, and the quest for power, then the reality of what is appears as the hidden treasure within ourselves. When that's discovered within yourself, the taste of that is such that you'll always be a good one. You'll always be a good one because nothing else satisfies. Nothing else brings liberation but the taste of that secret hidden treasure within the power of compassion and love. So I want to end with a prayer that that great power that placed the longing to know it within us, that awakens us to the wonder of the formlessness of consciousness itself, the thing in our hand that touches that can't be touched, the thing in our eyes that sees that can't be seen, the thing in our heart that knows that can't be known as an object, because it is the mystery of ourself and it is one. That great mystery of life itself, the purpose of our being here, to know that mystery, teaches all of us the way of coming into it is the realization it's not shrouded in darkness and confusion, and our faith should not be in ignorance. But it is where the luminosity of love is, and that is where the mystery is found, and that is where the meaning is found. And those who find it bring it into action because it acts through us. It's always acting through us, but it acts through us as a blessing when we surrender. Every wave is unique. Every one of us has a unique face. Every one of us is a unique moment. The wave realizes itself when it bows down. Aha, I am the ocean. I am the other waves. I am one. May we bow down in love and that melting heart of compassion so we can stop the melting of the ice cap and realize our unity. All praises are to that one. All praises are to the one who calls us together. All praises are to that one. And thank you for my brothers and sisters for responding to the call of love. All praises are to that power of love. Amen.
Mm-hmm. Amen. Jonathan, thank you for that prayer. Thank you for that offering. And we just turn within for a second and we just give thanks to the great God of the universe that's everywhere present. And that by means of us is knowing itself more completely through our uniqueness and our individuality as individual expressions of the Most High, individual meaning undivided. We give thanks for this. We bless this day. We embrace Sister Jenna as she's traveling safely. We bless each other and give thanks that we are available to be a blessing now and unto forevermore. And so it is, and so we let it be. Amen.
Amen. Beautiful, brother. Thank you, Adil.
Peace and blessings.
Thank you, guys. Thank you.
Good to see you guys again.